what is written here? It is impedance audiometry, isn't it? Impedance audiometry. What is that? It is in, what is the meaning of impedance? Impedance means resistance. So, impedance audiometry is a measure of resistance or the impedance offered by the tympanic membrane and the middle ear conducting mechanism to sound pressure transmission. Okay. And this is an objective method of evaluation of hearing. And this contains two parts, that is tympanometry and acoustic reflex. So today, I'll deal with this impedance audiometry. What is tympanometry? What is acoustic reflex analysis? What are the uses? And I'll also show you how to perform a tympanometry. As I have told, already I have told in class on Puretone Audiogram, this can be asked as OSCE station for doing a DOPS procedure scale. Okay. The physiology of hearing was already discussed in an earlier classes. And so now you know that when a sound pressure comes and hits the tympanic membrane, some of it here, when it comes and hits the, this is the tympanic membrane and this is the middle ear ossicle. And when it comes and hits the tympanic membrane, some part of it is going or absorbed and some is reflected. So when the tympanic membrane is stiffer, what will happen? More of reflection will happen. And so with a probe used here, we can increase or decrease the air pressure in the external auditory canal, and the amount of sound wave reflected can be measured. Understood? So this amount of sound pressure reflected will depend upon the compliance of the ossicular system and the tympanic membrane. What is this compliance? It is the opposite of impedance, isn't it? So compliance is the suppleness. So the reflection will depend upon the compliance. Okay. So in a tympanogram, we have basically a machine and a probe. Hold this is a probe, and this probe has got three channels. One is an oscillator which delivers a tone, and for adult it is usually 226 hertz. It delivers a tone. And this second is an air pump. Air pump will increase or decrease the pressure in the external auditory canal. And the third is a microphone which pick up and measure the amount of sound that is reflected. There are some instructions to be followed which are same as that of a Puretone audiogram. I have discussed that along with my class on Puretone audiogram. So this, as this is an objective method, the very little of patient cooperation is needed. So what is the advantage? You can do this in children. Okay. But at the time of doing the procedure, the body should be maximum still. Patient should not move. That has to be instructed. All other instruction, examination of ear, what all things you have to examine and what are the other instructions to be given, all are explained along with my class on Puretone audiogram. The same has to be followed here also. And now you just see how you perform, how we perform a tympanometer.
Audiometer, for which it has got two channels, two modes, one for tympanometry and another one for acoustic reflex assessment. And here we are performing the tympanogram. So on it, select the mode for tympanometry, and for it. Just got different button for right ear and also for the left ear, and take the probe and fit it snugly. It should snugly fit into the external auditory canal. Fit it, and then you on the tone switch. We give a tone at 226 hertz, and here you can see the graph getting plotted. Which is this graph? Which is the type of curve here? It is a curve, which is normal, isn't it?
And you saw how a type A curve is got. Like that, this is plotted in a graph. With an x-axis is pressure, that is in pascals or in millimeters of water. And the normal pressure is always taken as atmospheric pressure, that is zero. And negative plotting and positive plotting will be there. And the vertical axis is for compliance. The normal adult compliance is between 0.3 to 1.6 centimeter cubed, or ml also you can take it. And for children, this can, the lower limit can be up to 0.2. So the normal curve is an A curve, which comes from at 0. Okay, this will be like this. This is an A curve. A curve is normal. And another one is an AS curve, that is for a very stiff tympanometry. Okay, that is the compliance is very much reduced with a normal pressure. So it will be like this. Okay, AS curve you get in tympanosclerosis, otosclerosis, very stiff tympanic membrane. Okay, and that is AS curve. And another one is AD curve. AD curve you get in a ossicular discontinuity with or very lax tympanic membrane. So the compliance is very high. Okay, compliance is very high, but pressure will be normal. Okay, so that is AD curve. And another type is an B curve. B curve, which is a flat curve, which you get specifically in a secretory otitis media. This is a B curve. Okay, fluid in the middle ear, you get a B curve. And this B curve is a gold standard in the diagnosis of a secretory otitis media. And also there is a high B curve. You get a high compliance B curve. And that is seen in case of a perforated tympanic membrane or when the patient is having a growment in situ. Okay, this is also B curve. High B curve you get in a perforated tympanic membrane or with a growment in situ. And the low B curve is seen typically in case of secretory otitis media or in early stages of acute otitis media when there is fluid in the middle ear. And another one is a negative peaking curve, that is a negative middle ear pressure. That is C curve. And the C curve is typically seen in eustachian tube dysfunction when there is a negative middle ear pressure. Okay, so these are the different types of curve. Again, that is important. One is an A curve, which is normal. A is with reduced compliance. And an AD curve, when there is compliance is very high but the pressure is normal. And B curve, again a high B and a high B curve. And a C curve, which is a negative peaking curve, which is seen in eustachian tube dysfunction. So this is the acoustic reflex, and the principle is that when a loud sound, that is 70 to 100 dB above the threshold of hearing, given at 500,000, 2000 and 4000 hertz to the patient, there is contraction of the ipsilateral as well as the contralateral stapedius tendon. And there is movement of the stapedius foot plate. So we measure the this movement of the stapedius foot plate is measured using a tympanometry. Okay. So the pathway is when sound goes to the middle ear, it causes changes in the cochlea, which was already described with the physiology of hearing. Okay. And from there it goes through the eighth nerve to the cochlear nucleus. Then the superior olivary nucleus of same side and to the opposite side, isn't it? So the crossover occurs at the superior olivary complex level at brainstem. So from there there is crossing over to the opposite side, and then from there to the nucleus of motor nucleus of seventh nerve, then the facial nerve, the nerve to stapedius and the stapedius dendron, same side and to the opposite side. So this is the arc, and the afferent limb is the eighth nerve, and the center is the superior olivary nucleus, and efferent is seventh. So here comes the afferent limb, which is the eighth nerve, and the brainstem superior olivary complex comes the center, and this is the efferent. Okay, and what is the normal acoustic reflex? That is 120 milliseconds at 1000 hertz and 140 milliseconds at 2000 hertz. So this is how you do an acoustic reflex assessment, and what are the uses of this? One, I already told, this is an objective evaluation. So this can be done in children and young infants. Okay, because there is little cooperation is needed. And also this can be done when the patient is sleeping. So in an uncooperative child also we can do this at the time of sleeping. Okay, so one is in testing in children and young adults, and second in malingerers. Even if the patient says that I cannot hear while doing a Puretone audiogram, if you do an acoustic reflex, that will show a positive stapedial reflex. Okay, so second one use is children, can be done in children, and second is malingering. You can detect malingering in this. And third, you can differentiate between a cochlear lesion and a neural lesion. In a cochlear lesion, there will be recruitment, isn't it? So usually we give a stapedial reflex elicitation is at a sound frequency 70 to 100 dB above the threshold of hearing. But if it is in a cochlear lesion, even if we are giving a sound at 40 to 60 dB above the normal threshold of hearing, the stapedial reflex will be elicited. Okay, so that is due to recruitment in case of cochlear lesions. And in neural lesions, what will happen? Neural lesion, that is, there is chance of adaptation. So stapedial reflex decay will be positive. Okay, and another test uses in facial nerve palsy, topo diagnostic test, that was already discussed along with the disorders of facial nerve, and also the site of lesion, and also in cases of regeneration and earlier absent stapedial reflex will become positive, or the presence of stapedial reflex shows that the facial nerve is regenerating in case of facial nerve palsy. Okay, so I have discussed about the impedance audiogram, the tympanometry, how you perform a tympanometry, and acoustic reflex, the principle and mechanism behind each of that, and also the uses of tympanogram as well as an acoustic reflex assessment.